When people do a study of, for example, the double slit experiment, and they approach the double slit experiment in the traditional way, one particle at a time, a wave function that we can pretend is moving in three-dimensional space, but this is really just an artifact of the fact that configuration space for one particle looks three-dimensional. It looks like you should treat the particle as a wave as it goes through the slits to get the correct pattern over many repetitions of landing sites. You know, we don't actually see a wave on the other side. What we see is dots, many, many landing sites over many repetitions of the experiment. The wave is inferred. But when you measure where the particle is at the end of the experiment, or you measure which hole it goes through, you get a definite result, and that makes it look more like a particle. So there's this idea that sometimes things are particle-like and sometimes they're wave-like, depending on what feature of the system we're trying to study. This became known as wave-particle duality. This is further complicated by the fact that there are waves of a different kind in physics. Electromagnetic waves, for example. Light is a disturbance in the electromagnetic field that propagates like a wave through three-dimensional space. And those are waves. I mean, like I said, I teach Jackson electromagnetism. We talk about waves moving through three-dimensional space. It's very easy to confuse the waves of a field, like the electromagnetic field, with the wave functions or Schrodinger waves of quantum mechanics, but they're not the same thing. And this has bled into the wave-particle duality. When Planck in 1900 and Einstein in 1905 and various people were proposing that light came in quanta, discrete particle-like quanta called photons, the wave that they were imagining was the wave corresponding to photons was a three-dimensional electromagnetic wave, a wave of the familiar kind of wave. The wave functions that Schrodinger introduced in 1926 were not like those waves. They were not three-dimensional waves in physical space of a field. They were these abstract, complex-valued functions in a high-dimensional configuration space. And when you measured them, they collapsed. Now, if you're in an MRI machine and they've turned on a very strong magnetic field, you don't have to worry that if you do the wrong measurement, you're going to collapse the magnetic field in the MRI machine. It's not that kind of field. The waves they're beaming at you are not those kinds of waves. So you have to make a distinction between field waves, the waves of a field, and Schrodinger waves. And I want to make super clear that in the indivisible stochastic approach to quantum mechanics that we've been talking about, I'm saying Schrodinger waves are not real things. These abstract things that live in this high-dimensional configuration space, those are not physically real. But classical waves, or the waves of a field, which are a different, conceptually different kind of a wave, those are perfectly valid. And if you're studying a system that's not made of particles, but a system made of fields, you're going to see wave-like behavior as well. But those are a different kind of wave. And these are the kinds of subtleties that I think get lost when someone just says wave-particle duality. So again, just to summarize, the relationship between a photon, a particle of light, and an electromagnetic wave is not like the relationship between an electron and a Schrodinger wave function for the electron. Now, what makes this even more confusing is that electrons do have fields also. There's a so-called Dirac field that plays a very important role in the Standard Model. And this is a field in three dimensions for the electron. But the Dirac field for the electron is not the Schrodinger wave for an electron. So, you know, these are super subtle distinctions, but it's important to keep them in mind. What makes it even more confusing is that particles like electrons, which are called fermions, these are particles that have an intrinsic half-integer spin. They're the particles that obey a Pauli exclusion principle. You can't put them all in the same energy state. They make chemistry possible by not having all the atoms collapse to the ground state. Electrons are like this, quarks, protons, neutrons. Although they have fields associated with them, the fields associated with them are not classical fields like the electromagnetic field. The fields are much more bizarre and weird. And I'm not going to have time to talk very much about them, except to say that one of the limitations of Bohmian mechanics is that it has a great deal of difficulty dealing with the kinds of fields associated with fermions. And that's one reason why Bohm mechanics has difficulty, the Bohm pilot wave theory. I'm getting way ahead of myself, but I just wanted to just clarify what's going on in wave-particle duality. So in the indivisible stochastic approach, there are no Schrodinger waves as part of the fundamental physics. Of course, you can, when you go to the Hilbert space picture, you can mathematically write down wave functions and use them, write down Schrodinger waves, but they're not physically there. You don't need them to explain the interference patterns. The indivisible stochastic dynamics itself generically predicts that you'll have what look like, over many repetitions of the experiment, dots that look like they're following some kind of wave equation, but there is no wave actually involved in those experiments. But I'm not saying that field waves, the waves in fields, are not there. That's a different kind of wave.
So, speaking of these waves, you mentioned quantum field theory for indirectly with Dirac. Does your approach illuminate any aspect of quantum field theory or the standard model? We've been talking about quantum mechanics, sure, especially in part one and part two. What about QFT?
Yeah, so one of the nice things about Bohm's pilot wave theory is that it works really beautifully for systems of fixed numbers of finitely many non-relativistic particles. That's a lot of qualifications. Doesn't work so easily for fields. You end up either having to do very complicated things or maybe even introducing stochasticity of some kind. It gets kind of messy, and there's a lot of difficulty handling fermionic fields in particular, the fields associated with particles like electrons. One of the advantages of this approach is, although, okay, so one of the, so let me just say something very quickly about Bohmian mechanics now. This is different because this is also related. In Bohmian mechanics, for, again, systems of fixed numbers of finitely many non-relativistic particles, we have deterministic equations. There's a pilot wave that guides the particles around. The wave function, the pilot wave, obeys the Schrodinger equation. Then another equation called the guiding equation is how the wave function, the pilot wave, guides the particles around. And everything is deterministic. There's no fundamental probabilities. There are some initial uncertainties in the initial configuration of the system. And these evolve to become the Born rule probabilities later. But the dynamics is fundamentally deterministic and is not generating the probabilities in a fundamental law-like way. This picture is in some ways very elegant, provided you're okay with a pilot wave living in a high-dimensional configuration space. Although I should say that Goldstein, Durr, and Zangi have already proposed the idea that the Bohmian pilot wave is law-like and not a physical thing. So there are other ways to read this theory. The problem is it helps itself to a lot of very special features of models that consist of fixed numbers of finitely many non-relativistic particles, features that are unavailable when you go to more general systems like fields. So you end up having to write down a very different looking model, including in some cases models that you need to now deal with stochasticity and indeterministic dynamics, and they just don't really work very well when you try to go beyond. One of the other things that Bohmian mechanics requires is a preferred foliation of spacetime. So last time we spoke, we talked about how in special relativity, there's no preferred way to take space and time and divide it up into moments of time, like different ways to do it. The guiding equation, the equation that takes the pilot wave and explains how the pilot wave, obeying the Schrodinger equation, how the pilot wave guides the particles around, called the guiding equation, depends on there being a preferred foliation of spacetime, a slicing of space into moments of time. That's also not really great. It works fine in the non-relativistic case, but when you want to do relativistic physics, like we often do when we want to do quantum field theory, which is the kind of models we use when we want to deal with special relativity and quantum mechanics together, as in the standard model, a preferred foliation is really difficult to deal with. Not impossible, but it'd be nice if we didn't need it. In the indivisible stochastic approach, there's no guiding equation. There's no pilot wave. It's not that you solve the Schrodinger equation, get a pilot wave, and then take the pilot wave and plug it into a guiding equation, which depends on a preferred foliation, and then the guiding, none of that happens. There's just the indivisible stochastic dynamics, which can be represented in Hilbert space language. But the dynamics is just directly happening. There's no middleman. There's no pilot wave and guiding equation in the middle. This means the theory is not going to be deterministic. I think one question in the comments is this fundamentally deterministic or not? It's indeterministic. It's not a deterministic theory. But because there's no guiding equation, there's no preferred foliation. And because we're not relying on all these special features of the particle case, it's perfectly easy to now generalize this to more general kinds of systems.
Have you done it?
Have I done it? Good question. So there's this thing called time. And time is bounded and limited.
Is it?
It is, amazingly.
In your framework?
At least in,
even in yours?
In my life.
Okay.
And when we get to open questions like research directions, which maybe people watching this may be interested in, because, I mean, the best part of a new formulation or picture or model or whatever is, are there things people can work on? There are things people can work on. This is one of the things people can work on. So it is, the term here is straightforward in principle to generalize this to quantum fields, because there's no, none of the obstructions are there like they were before. One of the problems with Bohmian mechanics is your wave function has to live in a space, configuration space. And fermionic particles don't have a familiar kind of configuration space. This is what makes it so hard to do Bohmian mechanics. But there's no pilot wave here, so you just don't even have that obstruction. So many of the things that would have obstructed us from just applying this to any kind of system are just, they're just not there anymore. So if you want to deal with a field theory, you just replace particle positions with localized field intensities. These become your degrees of freedom. And then you just apply the stochastic laws to them, and it works the usual way. The problem with quantum field theory is that quantum field fields in general is that they have infinitely many degrees of freedom, infinitely many moving parts. At every sort of point in space, in the most sort of, you know, I mean, this is a whole renormalization story, effective field theory, but like at a simplest sort of like bird's eye view, you have a degree of freedom every point in space, infinitely many of them. And this makes them very mathematically difficult to deal with. Even in the traditional Hilbert space or path integral formulation, quantum field theories are really mathematically tricky. And there are very few, if any, I think there are none, rigorously defined quantum field theories that are also empirically adequate. Like, none of the quantum field theories that make up the standard model have been rigorously defined. This means that anytime you mention quantum field theory, you're going to run into mathematical difficulties that are just because quantum field theory is mathematically very complicated. So I think there's a research direction for an enterprising student to not only formulate quantum field theory in this language, but also see, does it make any of the mathematical difficulties easier? Do any of them become harder? Like, what exactly does it look like when you do this super carefully? And that's, I would say, an open research question. But many of the obstructions that are in the way in, for example, Bohmian mechanics are no longer in the way here.
New update. Started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.